So education has evolved and learning process is no longer restricted by geography. Technology has enabled millions of youth across India an opportunity to access better education and build a better future for themselves and the century ahead. I take the opportunity to welcome and introduce our guest and panelist, Professor Manoj Singh Gaursahab. He is director at IIT Jammu. And prior to IIT Jammu, he has served MNIT Jaipur. Good to see you, sir.
Thank you.
And the next panelist is Dr. R. Ramanan. Ramanan, sir, are you there? I think Ramanan, sir, has yet not joined.
He is joined.
Oh, welcome, sir. Dr. Ramanan is first mission director, Atal Innovation Mission. He has contributed in a phenomenal way, the way he established Atal Tinkering Labs across the country in various schools, as he has also served as senior vice president, TCS. The third panelist is, welcome, sir.
Hi.
Hello. Good to see you.
How are you?
All well. Good to see you after such a long time. I think after 4 or 5 months.
Yeah. Good afternoon to everybody.
Good afternoon.
So next guest is Mr. Avinash Vashist. He's from San Jose, California. Thank you, sir, for being with us. You know, it's our time there. He is chairman of the board of Thailong Incorporation and former chairman and CEO Accenture India. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much.
Hi, Avinash.
Hi, Ramanan. How are you? Very, very nice to see you after such a long time.
Yeah. How are you doing? You're in...
Very good. Yeah, Ramanan and I know each other for what? 2.5 decades at least.
Yeah.
If not three.
Great. And the next guest is Dr. Buddha Chandrasekhar. He's Chief Coordinating Officer at AICT. He's contributing in different capacity to build different platform, NEET, and you know, making the content, digital content available to the students. Welcome, Dr. Buddha.
Namaste, ji. Namaste to all.
So to begin with, Manoj Singh Gaur, first of all, congratulations for you know, your contributions at IIT Jammu. We are abreast about all the updates of their campus. I keep hearing about the developments through Professor Anurag Mishra, sir.
Thank you.
So during the last 2 years, during pandemic time, we have accelerated, you know, use of technology, especially for teaching and learning process. In what way, I mean, you can throw some light on this is just a beginning or still we need to explore a lot the use of technology for education.
Yeah. So like I can... I won't claim myself to be an expert in this area, but as a new institution, we have to keep it abreast with the latest, what is happening around us. And we have a chance to absorb what is best for us, value for money as well. So I think what we're talking about is technology for learning anywhere, anytime, and the evolution of the same, right? Of the set. So a few things I'll touch upon. Which I presumably I missed out Sancheti ji because we were in panel earlier and he was my teacher as well actually sometime. So so what before the pandemic, in fact, at IIT Jammu we saw things happening in different ways. Typically different kind of lockdowns happened in August 2019 as well. We're in a campus and you know things were not happening outside typically. And we had to function actually as an institution where we had around 800 odd students on campus and they need to be taught. Labs have to function in a given situation around us. And since we adopted technology at very early stage as for whether it's a campus automation, workflow automation, we did the deep tech platform. And we evolved over time in the last 2 years. We invested ourselves into it. And that paid off at that time. We learned that how to function without any issues while there is a lockdown around us. And that became very handy when this pandemic hit us in March 2020. And so movement from offline, completely offline to online became not a very disruptive for us. But again, it has remained a very learning experience. So our platform, which already was available, so we converted our 19 classrooms quickly to a hybrid mode, in a sense that we had the studio classrooms, all of them. Since the new institutions, we are creating infrastructure, we converted them quickly to that. So, and we did a pan-IIT survey at that time. Nearly 1,200 students participated and around 150 faculty members across all the IITs. Because that was a sample we are looking at. That during March till May, when we are trying to struggle that how to evaluate the half semester instruction towards the grading at the end of it, what are the various ways to conclude that semester? And one batch need to pass out, and that was the first batch for us, 2016 to 2020. So the biggest input came from the students was about the quality of content which was being offered to them. Because initially, all of the faculty were offering like PDF version of the classroom teaching. And that was not good enough for our students. But we evolved pretty fast. We started working on a platform. Initially, we took services of a startup company called IPER. It was again IIT Madras kind of setup, where we put closed captions, video searches as part of the content creation. And then slowly we created our own platform, which we have done this semester and last 1 year. We evolved it, we matured it, and that became very handy. So this became a norm for us, in a sense that all the lectures being recorded, part of LMS, which used to be part earlier also, but it was not uniform and universal across all the courses. Because currently, IIT Jammu, we are offering like 6 BTech programs and 5 MTechs. Only second batch just graduated 2 days back, convocation happened, when there was a cloud burst, of course. So we were dealing with that. As I said, that around 160 to 170 courses we are offering now completely online. We tried a bit our hands-on on virtual labs as well. But again, the experience is mixed with this. We have to mature even further that how to make all across all the disciplines it can happen. Still a lot to learn and a lot to offer in terms of content creation. One thing which we learned in a big way, because it's a very engaging process with the students of different places. They have different issues about having a lower bandwidth access in the villages. Even the quizzes with the continuous learning, they have to move to different cyber cafes to give the quizzes. So we have to measure up and get them actually on the campus on the basis of that. But what we realized that the blended learning model can work out if we plan ahead of it, actually. So this exercise, as I said, we are still learning and we are trying to enrich our processes and fine tune it for this. But at the same time, NEP 2020 became very handy for the self-paced learning, because ABC, what we call the Academic Bank of Credit, while choosing the courses and accepting the courses from across institute become possible. And so as an institution, we start offering few minors to other institution within Jammu and Kashmir, where our courses are accepted by them. And our students are doing some online platform like Coursera and few other places. Wherever there is a credit deficit, we are permitting them to in proctorial mode. We started using or leveraging technology to large extent for online as well as offline mode. And now the content creation with different kind of boards and different kind of different kind of I would say elements in the teaching has become a standard phenomena, and we used, and these are experiments which we created our own in our campus. And the class size is no more a boundary, because till now we used to think that within a time slot, whether we can have 120 students sitting in a class, and the pandemic actually stresses more when we are talking about social distancing within labs and classrooms. So online gave a method by it become even more possible NPTEL was there, but it was only one-way communication. But having two-way communication with richer content now is possible with even a next version of platform, be it Zoom or Google Meet or Microsoft Teams. So these platform, and there are many more in open source which are now available, and they have democratized the access to knowledge. Our classrooms are now scalable, whether I'm taking 50, 100 or 500. In these platforms, if we have rich content, people will come and attend it. We have started offering e-mode of a few credits and the programs, which are inter-institutional. Like recently, we launched two programs, one with IIM Jammu. This year, Advanced JEE, we are offering around 20% seats by which the students will do the BTEC program with us and then go to do MBA with IIM Jammu without actually appearing in CAT. So it is a recipe. For the first time, we are doing two institutions come together. The second program we are doing with IIT, IIM, and AIIMS, in medical domain, medical management, administration. And this has become possible because one is co-location, second is technology is actually getting into in our structural health. And right now, still, because we keep on talking about the examination and evaluation connected with the grades. So proctored examination is still remain a challenge because there we'll find that people use different methods to share their conventional.
I'll come back to you about the accountability of candidates. Yeah. And thank you for, and congratulations to you. Short span of 2 years of time. From zero to,
It's a 4 years actually, not 2 years. It's
more 4 years. Okay.
Thank you.
So now coming to Dr. Ramanan. Manoj sir has, given a lot about the usability of technology for blended teaching learning process. So that is the innovation in education. So from innovation in education to education for innovation, you have been master of that. So would like to know your experiences about education for innovation, Dr. Ramanan.
Thank you, Puneet, for first of all, giving me a chance to participate in this very, very interesting and thought-provoking discussion that is always very beneficial for our country. And it's great to be among a part of a very illustrious panel here. And I do hope all the people who are listening to this are hale and hearty in spite of this difficult COVID-19 circumstances, and that all are following the safeguards advocated by your institutions, local authorities, and by the local health governments. What has been remarkable about the initiatives that the government has been making in education are twofold. One, how can you become innovative in education? And I think Dr. Manoj Gaur beautifully expounded all the initiatives that are going on in order to bring innovation in the educational systems, the processes, the pedagogies that we have, the methodologies that we have been developing, and to really look at education from the point of view of how can we reinvent education, leveraging technology, which is changing the very shape of the world in which we are living in, and which on a daily basis, we are experiencing the world in a different way, and the world is experiencing us in a different way. And I think a panel like this or a discussion like this was one of those very few things that were occurring just a couple of years ago. And today, this has become the norm. So that shows how, from education, which is all at the end of the day, how do you communicate knowledge and how do you leverage that knowledge for the benefit of humanity is the purpose of education. At the same time, the government has been taking very strong and very, I would say, creative initiatives in being able to spread the culture of innovation through education. And that is where the Atal Innovation Mission and initiatives like that have come in. After all, we are a country of 1.3 billion people. We have 1.4 million schools. We have the demographic dividend that everybody talks about. 65% of our country is under 35 years old. We have more than 50% of our country under 25 years old. And we have 10,500 engineering institutions, we have 39,000 colleges, we have universities and so on and so forth. So we have a huge flow of youthful energy coursing through our nation, through these educational systems that we have set up in our country. And we have a very large country, a country is so big,
Ensuring that the quality of education, uniform access and universal access to education, empowering young students everywhere, whether they be from the tier one, tier two cities or from rural India, all of this needs the innovation in education and an approach, innovative approach that Dr. Manoj talked about. At the same time, it becomes imperative for us to make our young students who are graduating from the universities and from the schools and entering into the industry, how do you make them very, very innovative? How do we create the job creators tomorrow, as they say? How do we create people who become problem solvers and not just interested in rote learning so that they just graduate to a university, go to another university abroad, graduate from there, get into a big job, whether it is TCS, Wipro, Google, or IBM. We have really become very good in job seeking, and that's the strength of the Indian education system, I would say. We have built $190-200 billion IT/ITS industry so far because of our emphasis on education, rote learning, and so on. But if what brought us here is not going to take us further, because India has many challenges. India is, as I said, 1.3 billion people, and if you want to carry them along, you need to ensure that the whole of India develops. It's the 715 districts, the 650,000 villages, the 8,000 small towns and cities that are scattered across the country, and not just the 8 tier one cities where most of us have flocked in order to get the benefits of education. So we need our young students to become the transformers of tomorrow, and therefore we need them to become very innovative, and we need them to get inducted into problem solving and innovation. And that's where the Atal Innovation Mission, for example, has realized, and NEP 2020 talks about all of this. You know, how do you create inclusive education so that from Sikkim or Salem or from Jodhpur, people have the same quality of education and generate the same type of people? After all, if you look at some of the outstanding innovators who have come from India, they come from the rural places, whether it's Abdul Kalam from Rameshwaram, Ramanujam from Kumbakonam, and so on and so forth. Countless examples are there where people who have come to the very top are from the remotest places. So we have set up thousands of what we call as Atal Tinkering Labs to stimulate this problem solving, innovative thinking in the young students, so that you are able to expose these young children to the latest of technologies, because technology has become affordable, accessible, available, and advanced. You're exposing them to the latest of technologies so that they can tinker with them, play with them in an atmosphere of fun, creativity, and learning, not burdened by, is this going to help me score more marks? But the pure joy of learning and working together in small teams, being able to acquire 21st century skills like communication, like collaboration, like design thinking, like problem solving, and an approach where you are enabling the young student to go and look at the problems in and around the society they live in, rather than just absorb a lot of knowledge and then don't know what to do with that. So these tinkering labs are now creating the next generation of innovative young students who are going to become entrepreneurs and the job creators of tomorrow. Similarly, now today, for example, we have over 10,000 tinkering labs set up. Of course, we have 1.4 million schools, and we have 640,000 higher secondary and secondary schools. We need to ensure that the access of an Atal Tinkering Lab, if not an Atal Tinkering Lab itself, is available to these 640,000 schools. So that's a big task ahead of us, which needs a tremendous collaboration of private sector, public sector, state and local government, and central government to make this happen. Secondly, at the university level, in order to stimulate this innovative entrepreneurial culture, we are now creating an enabling ecosystem. So India has never lacked for great innovators or thinkers, as I said. You have a Sundar Pichai heading Google, Shantanu Narayan heading Adobe, and Arvind Krishna heading IBM, and you have Microsoft being led by all Indians. So when they get that ecosystem of innovation, they blossom to their full potential. Similarly, in India, we are creating this ecosystem of incubators, world-class incubators to foster world-class startups, and community innovation centers, so that you are really spawning innovation local to the job creation needs of that community. If you're in Goa, how do you boost the fishing industry, the tourism industry, the mining industry, or the shipbuilding industry, or the cashew nut industry? So you need to boost innovation, and that means teaching young students graduating from our universities how to become innovative in spotting these opportunities and transforming India, you know, across the length and breadth of our country. And I think that has been a very important part in our rise, I would say, of the Global Innovation Index from 81 to a position of 48 just in 5 years. It's amazing. I think now it is at 46. So this leap, which is possible for India, and I would dare say that in the next 10 years, we can be among the global top 10 most innovative countries of the world. And that is possible with the reforms happening, innovative reforms happening in our education system, and innovative students coming out of it because of the enablement of an innovative ecosystem for them to tap into. And I would just like to finally say that, you know, one of the important initiatives the government has had in all of this is how do you ensure knowledge of sustainable development goals and make it mainstream in the creation of innovation or innovative products and services. And that again has been a very important factor because we need our young children and the next generation to be so much aware of the problems that they can potentially create if you're not aware of what goes into sustainable innovation. So I think these initiatives are finding result. We are now a nation of 55,000 startups, more than 400 incubators. Last count was almost there are 600 incubators. And I think these are very good things to create what you said as a second part, the innovative culture and innovative students coming out of a reformed innovative education system.
Thank you, Dr. Raman, for throwing lots of information about education for innovation. Well said about the need of, you know, industry to come together with academic institutions to develop a proper ecosystem for innovation system. So coming to Mr. Avinash Vashishta. So young mind is there, mentors are there, but problem statements are missing. So might be that problems are big for any industry, but the solution can be provided by a young mind quite easily. And this has happened, you know, on several occasions. We have witnessed this in Smart India Hackathon. Young guys, young students, undergraduate students, they are preparing solutions for industry as well. So I would like to request you to throw a light on the power of collaboration of industry and academic institutions to develop an ecosystem for innovation as well as and to fund also.
Right. No, I think, thank you so much. Very, very nice listening to Ramnan and Dr. Manoj. Very nice. And I think for me, the collaboration with industry and the academics, for example, has been there from a very, very long time. When I graduated from IIT Kanpur, and in fact, we were kind of in the final year, even though, you know, I had already decided that I wanted to go, you know, abroad for higher studies, but still you go in for interview, you know, just to make sure. And so especially when we went to manufacturing companies, I graduated from electronics and electrical engineering. And one of the comments that I really got and which I remember even today is, I know, you know, ITs are great, they do great education, but why are you guys not relevant to the industry? Relevant to the industry. So that's been there forever. And in fact, when I was the chair for the FICCI Education Committee, you know, all of the vice chancellors and others used to say, well, you know, the education versus training. So the job of the education is to educate people, the basic stuff, and not really align them to industries. But if you look at today, and I think, Dr. Manoj, you talked about how the pandemic has taught us so many things, and you yourself are right now collaborating between the IIMs, the Auden Institute, and the IITs. And today, for example, if you look at any job requirement, any job description, it will also give you examples of what kind of tools you need to be familiar with or have experience with, fine? And some of these names are changing so fast that I don't even know. For example, you know, I don't necessarily use a Facebook, you know, and but my children use all kinds of social media. My youngest daughter is a social media, you know, expert, if you may. And, you know, there are tools like Hotspot, Jira, and Asana, and, you know, Google Ads, and so on and so forth, which they need to know. Without that, there's no marketing, for example, fine. You know, I think when I became the chairman of Accenture, and we had a lot of these clients from the US and other places, I remember almost every client used to say, you know what, guys, we really want you guys to help us innovate. And you know, before you know, like the, for example, 2010, when someone said that we would love you to you know, help us innovate, it was a big question mark for me. But I think from 2010 onwards, it wasn't a question. It was a question that I love to be asked. And the way I kind of used to explain to people is, just imagine if you're wearing a Fitbit watch. Now today we have Fitbit watch, we have Apple watch, but let's say you're wearing a watch. And here comes a message to you saying that, you know, there is a very high likelihood that you may have heart problems in the next 6 hours. And you need to see and go and see the doctor. And then now you wonder as to how is that possible? It's possible because in all the data that is about you is being transmitted to an application on the cloud. That application on the cloud has data from a million previous patients, and it is able to diagnose based on your pulses as to what exactly is the problem and predict you know, what may be your health. And so you can go to the doctor and take care. But just on the converse of it, just imagine, why do you need to go and see the doctor every month or so if you have a device like that and says, you know, you seem to be okay? So I think that, so some of these things are a big collaboration of the technology and so on and so forth. Now, coming back to the collaboration. Now, innovation, I think the industry has accepted one thing, that the innovation doesn't help, you know, happen in the industry themselves. It doesn't, because everyone is out there to do a job. It doesn't give them time to think. It doesn't give them time to experiment. You know, it may be something that happens in the research labs of some of these companies, which have become very, very few. I think the research lab that we still have and the research capability that we still have in the institutes, in the education academics, is still great. But more importantly is the youth of today, I mean, which is saying, you know, I want to really come up with something innovative. Now, you know, the fact is that there are loads of things that people see as an opportunity for them to innovate and contribute to it. So when you talk about a problem statement, I mean, the problem statement sometimes has to be realized. I mean, sometimes it stares in front of our eyes, but we don't even realize there's a problem out there. But for example, you know, when Uber talked about the taxi stuff, I mean, remember we used to kind of call up someone and say, can you please come up at 6 a.m. tomorrow morning? And sometimes if the guy doesn't show up, we are in big trouble in that sense, fine. I mean, this, you know, so when Uber says, well, you know, I guess I can have a network and I can make people available and so on and so forth. I mean, it was something that came about because people knew that, you know, the transportation, the taxis was an issue and the solution was amazingly great, fine. So, but it was a very innovative solution. In terms of the collaboration, I really believe, even though we may have the research labs, we may have academics, we may have entrepreneurs, the problem that still happens is how do you take that entrepreneur, that innovation out there to the world to solve real problems, by the way, right? And this is where I think I believe we need a network. One, we need mentors. Mentors who have been entrepreneurs, hopefully, but also have been in large enterprises, because they are required to be the bridge between the entrepreneurs, the academics, and the enterprise. So that's one thing. The second thing is you really need customers to kind of try out your ideas and things like that. So you need real-time clients. And the good thing is today, each and every Fortune 10, Fortune 100, Fortune 500 to Global 2000 companies is saying, we are extremely open to work with startups, because they know that if they don't, they will not exist tomorrow. So that's the first is the client stuff. Number three is basically you need digital platform. When I say digital platform, I mean, who is going to implement that solution at the client? You need, you know, companies like TCS, you need companies like Accenture and so on and so forth to be able to implement that platform. But today the platform is implemented on certain digital platforms. For example, you need Azure or AWS as a cloud hosting. And then you have loads of other tools which are there. CRM tools. I mean, you know, you don't have one CRM tool. Now you have CRM tools for different, you know, domains and things like that. So you need the digital platform, extremely important. And a lot of these digital platforms are giving, you know, entrepreneurs, for example, will give you a credit for $100,000-$200,000 in the first year or so to for you to basically start your business, essentially. So everyone is out there to kind of help out on the entrepreneurship. The other thing that you need is funding, right? So you need funding, money. And by the way, money is not difficult these days if you really have a great innovative idea, right? And more importantly, even a startup with all this network is sometimes not able to do it. They need to be part of a network of startups. And really speaking, because the thing is that, you know, just because you seem to be better, the best startup in Goa, you know, how do you scale up to, to Maharashtra? How do you scale up to all over India? Now, the competition is not just about India. The competition is global, right? So really speaking, you need to be connected to this network of startups that is there globally. So this is your collaboration system, by the way. So extremely, extremely important. So that's one of the things that, you know, whenever I've been involved with so many, you know, companies for my 20-year plus career in that sense. So that's what I say is that unless and until you have all these pieces and they collaborate together, you cannot have innovation at scale. And that is what we're talking about, is not just about innovation that we keep to ourselves. It is something that we can actually implement and realize at scale. Well, I can't hear you, Professor Puneet.
Thank you, Mr. Avinash, for giving a holistic view about academia, industry, and innovation and further leading to startups. Now, moving to Dr. Buddha Chandrasekhar. Building a technology is, technology is needed to build an environment for collaborative learning at school level. So we have been discussing a lot about, university and college level. So school are the essential or first part of the education system. Technology-driven environment for school education system.
Sure, yeah. Good afternoon all. Since COVID, there is a tremendous change in our education system, especially teaching methods, quality of digital content and methodology. COVID pandemic pushed the students, including the school students, to remote and digital. Because my 5-year-old son, he uses Google Meet and WebEx on a daily basis to attend his classes. And he's in first standard. So you can understand, how deep the technology is penetrated from a classrooms to households. So now every household become a classroom. That's the beauty of the technology. And now the educators as well as institutes became more relevant on the technology than before. I mean, the educational institutes, in my point of view, which generates and decimates the knowledge. Therefore, an integrated and technology-driven system is going to become a very effectively in instrumental learning and exercising vocational, innovative startup and research activities. Because as of now, I see that I try to take things more towards innovative and creative side. So I started teaching various innovative creating methods to my 5-year-old child, because I strongly believe, that thinking out of the box and creative thinking is what we will left out, after a few years, because artificial intelligence is occupying the rest of the process. So with this 35% of 1.3 billion population is below 15 years of age, there will an increase in number of students who wants to get admitted into the institutes of world-class education system. So along with the existing infrastructure, I think the technology is the one which can help us. So we need a different kind of a strategies altogether required to prepare a school education as well as higher education sectors to basically meet the demand and supply, on the across the globe. So that's where I see the NEP 2020 comes into picture, where the thought process is basically to create Indian students as a world-class skilled workforce and empower with the new age technologies. Because, now even they know what is WebEx. And early morning, they are saying, I'm not able to connect. I'm able to connect. And, they're even doing 3D drawings. And by the way, he's in first standard. So I never know 3D drawings, till I was an engineering student. I think, we are giving them something which is the need of the hour, and the technology is the one which is enabling, and that in short translating our country as a knowledge superpower and innovation oriented, research oriented, entrepreneur oriented. So at the same time, I see the personalized learning is very, very important, because every student is unique and every student has a different way of learning. So the technology basically helping the students, including the school as well as higher education students, to go on a personalized way to learn things. Example, I'm pretty good in learning using graphs. So some people may be pretty good in learning on the research way. Some are in a pictorial way. You know, some on a video-based learning. I think this personalized and adaptive learning with help of the advanced technologies are changing a lot. And the 21st century skills, and you know, we recently even involved the artificial intelligence and pushing the files on the cloud. And the cloud is offering the private cloud as well as a public cloud. And if you see the virtual reality, because the recent technologies which we are even using in schools are virtual realities. The best example, they can see the entire school, you know, where they never even physically appeared. They can see their school on a virtual reality mode. I mean, the way we are, they are visualizing things are completely changing on the school level. Even the chatbots which we implemented on a school level are really adding a lot of value. And the chatbots are engaging with the students and responding back. So this is kind of a modern technology is what we are talking about. And I see that even they started pushing these things on the social media also. I mean, that is basically changing the way they learn. And the changing the way they understand, and it is improving the communication, it is improving the reading skills. Because nowadays what they are doing is, instead of going through a physical book, you know, my son started opening an ebook and started relating that, you know, with a couple of videos on YouTube. I think that's where the power of the technology comes into picture. And slowly what I realized, they started utilizing the games, because I built a small game for my son, you know, where the monkey throws a couple of bananas and he catches all those bananas. But I teach him the if and, you know, else clause and how you can do clause, you know. So without even understanding that, he is already involved in a logical, you know, computation using his brain. He is utilizing this gaming environment and trying to understand, trying to go get connected with this kind of a strategical, you know, functioning of a brain. Because I strongly believe the technology does one thing very, you know, very perfectly, that it enables and empowers the right as well as the left brain. And the interactive presentation boards, nowadays, I mean, we have in cities, but slowly we are trying to take it towards our villages side, where the interactive board is basically giving an opportunity to touch and feel. They are touching, they are feeling, and you know, they are basically interacting with that subject material. So that's a beautiful touch and learn, you know, is enabled with help of new technologies. And recently I wondered, because I'm taking my son, because you know, I'm experiencing it, he recently requested me to purchase a 3D printer. So I was amazed. I asked him, what do you want to do with 3D printer? The answer may amaze you. He said, I want to create an aircraft. So you buy a 3D printer so that I will utilize a 3D software and print a 3D aeroplane. I mean, you know, the kind of a technology empowerment and the advancement and the adaptability of our students are in a very, very higher scale. And very creative in nature, and they are, you know, these powerful tools are allowing them to put their creative thoughts in place, and they are trying to create a lot of things. And they started talking about projects, project submission. I mean, you know, this kind of a language what they are talking about. And I see the MOOC is one thing, you know, the learning management systems, which become personalized and adopted in nature, allowing the students to learn much more. Let's say there is an issue, you know, when they're learning a topic,
the system basically adopting the learning methodologies and the struggles and the evolution of a student, and the learning management system adjusting and providing a content in a way that the student is interested to learn the subject which is lagging. I think this kind of empowerment with help of technology is really enabling them a lot. And recently, I mean, I have seen another pretty good thought process is podcasting. Because in a couple of areas where we have the internet limitation, what the teachers are doing is they are podcasting through audio version, and that can be penetrated through the 2G technologies very easily. And they are playing those, you know, user storytelling medias. I think, you know, this is again, I think we need to understand more and create such kind of a very unique podcast in different streams so that the creative knowledge of our students will increase. I mean, especially I'm talking from the school point of view. And this Generation Z, you know, which I call, they really need a very advanced research and innovation hubs. Because recently we started something called Yukti for higher education students. But I see that we need a similar kind of a model. And one of the directors spoke about Atal Tinkering Labs. I think, you know, we need to give much more penetration. What industry needs, I think, you know, we need to connect them at least when they reach the sixth or seventh standard. If we give them an opportunity to learn these real-time applications on and they go and visit the industries, and if they go and work for as a vocational course, you know, if they go and attend some of the recent technological innovations, I think this is where I see that there's lots of opportunity, and the technology became a culture. You know, it is not a tool anymore. You know, it became a culture nowadays because everyone using the technology left and right. And at the same time, for the higher education, as we are here, you know, we have a thought of learn while you earn, earn while you learn. We have created an internship portal where we are giving an opportunity to students to get an opportunity to work with the real-time industries on a real-time projects. So we recently, I mean, you know, in last 1 year when we started, we have focused on skill-based education. And we have provided more than 11.8 lakh internship opportunities to the higher education students and recent graduates. And now slowly we are moving this platform towards school, because the thought process here is we will give them a local problems and let our students, school students or higher education students solve those problems and come back. Because see, every time when we look around, there are lots of problems exist, but all those problems are created by fellow humans, right? I think it is our students will look into the problem and solve the problem by you know, getting some kind of a mentorship using our internship portal. I think this is where we see, and we are creating a synergy between the students and the industry. And I'm happy to share that we have 2.3 crore registered users in that 70 lakh verified students with 30,600 plus MNCs, central government and PSUs are participating and providing internship opportunities to students. And just now I came back from Rural Development Ministry, where they have more than 6 lakh plus villages. They are also coming on board, because our strong thought process is from Ministry of Education point of view. The minute we empower the villages, you know, then the entire country will get empowered. So giving an opportunity of a student who is residing in village is very, very important. So we are going to provide internship opportunities and apprenticeship opportunities to the students who is living in small remote areas and tandas. And adding the vocational education for school children to the internship portal, you know, is another area where we are strongly working.
We'll come back to you on that. But this is quite clear that catch them young is the right way to impart technology in education. And as you have very well quoted your own experience, a young boy of 5 years is so adaptive, open for exploration of new technologies, including 3D printer. Such a wonderful phenomenon. Thank you, Dr. Ramanan. that the seeds you inculcated 5 years back, they are providing fruits to the society. Now, coming back to you, Dr. Ramanan, rightly said by Dr. Buddha Chandrasekhar that we need to reach to the villages. Sir, but the problem of digital divide is there to reach to the extreme corners of country. So your take on that, the challenges to overcome this digital divide.
Yeah, thank you, Puneet ji. And I think all the previous speakers really brought out different facets of innovation in education as well as innovation in the educational system. I think a few points that I would like to share in addition to what has already been shared is number one, it's very important for us to focus on the quality of education. And how do we focus on the quality of education? Not only by providing and enabling universal access through digital technologies and digital transformation, which can come to our rescue. So that is one very big potent force that we all have and we should harness in order to be able to reach the power of education and empower students to the last mile, whether it be in remote cities, towns, villages, the 650,000 villages that Dr. Buddha talked about and so on. The second, when you talk of quality of education is standardization of tools. I'm not talking of standardization of education because education itself should have that freedom and the democratization necessary for young students to be able to learn on their own, tinker with the latest of technologies like he mentioned, 3D printing, robotics, IoT, miniaturized electronics, augmented virtual reality. These are all technology which are now available in schools, and therefore providing access to them enables automatically the freedom of thinking and the freedom of being able to innovate and learn by practical solution of problems. But I think it is also important for us to standardize on the availability of such tools. It cannot be just that a few schools have it and the others don't. And that's why, for example, Atal Innovation Mission is working very closely with CBSE and with Kendriya Vidyalaya and so on, that how do we provide universal access through a strong collaboration with industry partners. So it's not just the industry partners can be a source of problems for stimulating innovation, but they can also be very active partners in creating that ecosystem, because local industries require the local people to get empowered and educated to serve them rather than they having to depend elsewhere. So that's the second part. And I think the government is also making very strong initiatives through the National Mission for Education, which they have set up. They also created the Standards Board. And one big step that the government has taken is created this Ministry of Education rather than, MHRD now assuming a larger role of education, which includes a comprehensive vocational training as well as academic knowledge and pursuits. The third thing is, which is very important, is teacher training. We really woefully lack the quality of teachers that are required and the knowledge that the teacher should have on the latest of trends, whether it is technology trends or educational trends or pedagogical trends. So how do we build this huge gap, fill this huge gap? That is where I think the mentors of change sort of concept comes in very powerfully. If you want to be able to bridge the socioeconomic divide, we have a 250 million people in our country today, or more than that, close to 300 million, which is part of the middle class rising economy, who have benefited from education and who have passed on the fruits of their efforts to the younger generation, who is now becoming more savvy and so on. But what we need is another 300 million people to get added to this economy, because that's what this economy is capable of, with more than a billion people in our country. If you want to do that, we need to really launch strong mentor of change networks and encourage people from the industry, people who have been there, done that, had the ability to get the advantage of education to become mentors. And this is, and thereby you can fill this gap between what the teachers need as training and knowledge and what the industry people already have because of their exposure and their ability to learn and be able to pass it on. So we established an Atal Innovation Mission, for example, Mentors of Change Network. More than 10,000 mentors have registered. I really didn't think that it would come up so fast and so quickly.
And that showed the hunger of many people who have been the beneficiaries of a great education in our country to also become a part of playing a role in improving the educational ecosystem in our country. So we have now almost every tinkering lab has mentors, more than a couple of mentors who are associated with them. And these mentors come from the industry. They come from organizations like ISRO and AICTE. For example, we have a pact with AICTE. More than 40 international partners and industry partners from India have collaborated now on improving the Atal Tinkering Lab mentoring capability. And when we have 10,000, 15,000 mentors who are associated with these initiatives, and they are available now in all the districts, 715 districts, we have them available. That increases the power of quality education and filling the gap between what the teachers need. So the mentors are not only mentors to the young students in newer technologies and newer ways of thinking, but they're also mentors to many of the teachers who find them very useful. The fourth thing that I think is very important is this network of community innovation centers and incubators, more than 400-500 incubators which we have, the startups that we have. What we have requested is every one of them should become a playground for up and coming innovators, for them to know what innovation can lead them to, you know, entrepreneurial thinking and so on and so forth. It is not just problem solving and technical ability, but the ability of transforming an idea into a product or into a company that also needs to be taught and can be taught to the young people. They're very quick in absorbing it. In fact, you would be surprised to know that in the tinkering labs, you know, we run what is known as a tinkering marathon. And that tinkering marathon, more than 50,000, 60,000 students participate in it. And they actually create prototype of innovations, which are real, real problem solvers, not an academic essay saying this is how you can solve the problem, but it's actually a prototype of an innovation using tinkering lab technologies. And this is open to all the students, not just from the tinkering labs, but from all the schools. We found 45% of the winners in the last tinkering marathon of 200, the top 200 that we selected, were girl students. Now that showed, we were actually surprised with this number, because you don't have a 50% enrollment in schools of girl students. You have much less than 50%. Many girl students drop out in the last 2 or 3 years of high school for various reasons. But to have a 45% winners in the tinkering lab showed that technology, because it has become a great leveler, and multilingual approach. You know, in the tinkering labs, we encourage mentors to teach in the local language rather than in English and so on. So this multilingual approach and their ability to represent their creative power in their local languages, not saying that you do it in English or do it in Hindi or do it in this language, do it in a language which you are very comfortable, because we can see your innovation. We don't need language to demonstrate the power of your innovation. When we looked at this, we suddenly found so many people expressing themselves. So I think the multilingual approach that NEP 2020 has prescribed is going to be a big factor in bridging the socioeconomic divide. And when you talk about socioeconomic divide, I think the biggest gap that we have is foundational literacy and foundational numeracy. I think there is a lot of emphasis being given today by the educational authorities to ensure students get, they keep on passing every class, and you come to fifth standard and sixth standard, and you find that you are still very poor in understanding the language, whatever be the language in which you are teaching. Knowledge of English or Hindi or the local language is very poor, and knowledge of mathematics is very poor. And if you don't have these two fundamentals addressed, you may have very noble ambitions for your educational system, but it will not reach anywhere. So I think this focus on multilingual education and ensuring that you're divesting education of what I would say this great divide between English and a few other languages and the others, that divide, if you remove, you're going to see a completely new generation which is able to express itself in any language, but more importantly, express their talent. So I think these are some of the points. Also, I want to emphasize that the assessment framework, performance evaluation framework that has been developed as a part of NEP 2020, it's called PARAKH, P-A-R-A-K-H. And that performance assessment framework of knowledge is a very holistic approach towards assessing teachers' competence as well as the school's competence in being able to perform. We have set up what is known as an ATL dashboard in schools. It's completely online. And these dashboards are enabling a school to know where they are in the innovation scale as compared to many other schools. And it is a very simple measuring of very simple data. How many innovation projects you have, how many students have acquired this particular skill on IoT or and so on. There is a lot of self-learning material, self-learning graduation, self-learning courses. That's the power of digital education. And I think this PARAC framework will be very useful in bringing a higher quality of education and more importantly, recognizing exemplary teachers, exemplary mentors, and so on.
Thank you, Dr. Ramanan. The approach, the multilingual approach would be the game changer. And this is what has been emphasized in NEP also. Now coming to Mr. Avinash. Sitting on the other side of the world, how you see or foresee the technology-driven changes in agriculture, manufacturing, and service sector, especially health sector, so that the policymakers and the academicians from various institutions, they can make the necessary changes in policies and
Right. I think, for example, on the health sector, the COVID stuff really made a big impact. So if you already go and ask a lot of things, and I think Ramanan, you were also involved in some of those things as well, whereby some of the approvals that would have taken years to happen, happened in a matter of weeks, by the way. And so right now, for example, we do have online pharma happening. Yes, we'd have to have prescriptions online and so on and so forth. But if you look at it from a regulatory perspective, that's also a big change. But at the same time, you have a lot of diagnostic happening remotely. The fact that doctors can come on and diagnose you remotely, be able to do a prescription, and people can actually take that and follow through with the treatment itself, requires a lot of regulatory changes. So I think the government has really been very forthcoming, especially on the healthcare side because of the COVID, in terms of making those changes in that sense. Today, for example, I think being able to see a doctor through remote stuff, telemedicine stuff, is a very, very essential part of it. I think even when we go beyond this COVID stuff, I think some of those changes will remain for us. I think one of the things that I have always believed is that the care, the medical care, really is going to move more and more towards home. So for example, right now we have a lot of diagnostic devices, wearables, if you may, that can monitor your health significantly. I think the future is, for example, on the pharma side as well. I mean, right now, obviously people are trying to see as to how they can get a lot of this medication on a nasal platform, because the nasal way of delivery of medicine is extremely effective than the tablets or even the injection itself, fine? And so you will see a significant amount of technology where the medicines are going to move into the nasal stuff. If you look at a little bit more in the future itself, you're going to have medicine patches. That means the medicine will be delivered to you in patches. Now the patches are going to be controlled through AI. So depending on what your condition is at that point and given a certain prescription by the doctors that they can actually take care of certain doses automatically without referring to the doctor, those patches will be able to deliver the right dose essentially. So a lot of this care that you're looking at is getting away from the hands of the physical hospitals, from the hands of the doctors, by the way, into the AI and into technology and into devices. And a lot of diagnostic centers, I mean, you're already seeing diagnostic centers be there in the neighborhood, if you may. People don't have to go to the hospitals to really get the blood tests and other things done, x-rays done and things like that. So I think you will continue to see a significant emergence of diagnostic centers. In the US, for example, you have a lot of care centers all across the country. I mean, the big hospitals is not really something that is the trend in the US. I mean, there are emergency units, which are small emergency units in small centers, here in the US itself. So I think a lot of that stuff will become to the satellite stuff. Coming into the, for example, the agriculture stuff. I mean, we're not necessarily talking about genetically modified stuff, that's a different line of thing. But just for the organic stuff itself, I mean, very basic stuff, and there are a lot of innovation that are happening in India itself, where a lot of apps are there that basically provide the basic education to the farmers in terms of when they should put the seeds, when they should harvest, the water levels, the manure levels, and so on and so forth. So a lot of that stuff is happening. I remember my time in Accenture, Brazil, for example, was a center of excellence for us in terms of the agriculture, technology. And a lot of companies, a lot of Indian are there in Brazil who are actually leading some of the large agriculture, or tech companies in Brazil itself, because Brazil is a center of excellence. I think the collaboration, for example, again, I'll emphasize that, has to happen between some of these tech that is available in different countries, because India is such a big agriculture base. I think countries like Brazil and India should be doing a lot of collaboration and sharing on the agriculture side. I think if you look at cloud, now cloud is pervasive. It just transcends across all industries. I think people have to realize one thing, that the industries are going to become increasingly technology. When, for example, someone says, guys, why are you, even in investment, for example, I remember my investment manager saying, sir, you are very heavily invested in technology, you need to kind of diversify. And my thing is that, you guys do not understand one thing. Every industry is becoming technology. While Uber is transportation, it's a technology company. Airbnb is hotel, it's a technology company. And I think what you're seeing right now is even the chemicals, even the medical, the bio stuff, everything is being significantly impacted by technology. I think this is extremely important, that even our basic engineering is getting so much impacted by the new technology that's available, the new knowledge that is available, that we need to kind of incorporate the new face of technology, if you may, into our curriculums right from the beginning. I mean, Dr. Buddha, you talked about your five-year-old son. I mean, what do you do? How do you satisfy the curiosity? How do you satisfy the the desire for learning for a five-year-old? So I think we're not talking about this thing being there in engineering colleges or college. I think it needs to be there way up in the schools. I mean, it looks like we're not talking about kindergarten and the first standard itself. So technology is extremely pervasive. And I think, when people talked about at the time when the chips were invented, that the, for example, even the chips, the speed of the chips, we're really having exponential growth in terms of speed. And the amount of chips that are used are so tremendous right now. People could not even imagine when the chips were invented that they will be so pervasive. Today, because of the lack of chips, you have cars, you have the entire supply chain that is really being impacted globally in that sense. So I think to me, people should not look at technology as something which is technology and something of the future. Technology is the present, and technology is shaping already each and every traditional industry, and will continue to do so.
So changes are inevitable, and if somebody is not exploring the technology, definitely they won't be able to take a lead. So it is inevitable, and earlier is better. The academic institutions, no matter they're offering commerce or management or art or whatever the courses they're offering, they should join hand in hand in the technological tools of learning and execution as well. So last question to Dr. Buddha. Any platform for the purpose of evaluation? This is what we missed in the previous question. Learning tools are there, but what about the evaluation?
Yeah, there are a couple of platforms, but I don't want to recommend any platform per se, because I don't want to brand anyone. But the thought process here, what I strongly feel and believe, we need to have a future fit student. Because as we speak, if you see in last 2 years, the way we think, the way we adopt, the way we execute is changed. So you can imagine the current generation, when they become elders, I think lots of things will change. I think we need someone called a future fit student, who has a capability of problem solving, who has a capability of critical thinking, who has a capability of collaboration, because collaboration is also very, very important. Who has capability of creativity, and who has a capability of seeing the other side? You know, because what happens as we grow as an individual, you know, we are becoming more self-centric than a society-centric. I think if the systems can adjust themselves in a way that it has an adaptability of attaching other entities to the system, to so that the student can work together as a team and work on a real-time problems and has a self-initiative mode. Because sometimes it became more like gamification. Example, if you see now we have platforms like Swayam, Swayam Prabha, you know, Deeksha and e-Paathashala, you know, and virtual labs. But I truly see that most of the things are going to disappear in near future in the technology like AR, VR, and interactive videos, interactive PDFs, to provide an interactive content and personalized and customized learning is going to take care with help of advanced technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, natural learning processing, and voice-enabled system. I mean, my five-year-old son, you know, I again go back because I see the change in them. He goes to Amazon, he searches for something, and he shares that link to me saying that, can you please buy this for me? I was amazed because, you know, the way he is utilizing the voice services of Amazon, and he compares the voice services of Amazon and YouTube. And he says, you know what, Dad, there is a huge difference between these two, and YouTube voice works better than Amazon because, you know, Amazon basically categorizes, you know, they have a categorization and they basically give you some result. But in YouTube, he can search anything. You know, he simply goes to YouTube. He searches for the planets. He searches for different, galaxies in the universe. And he started learning. I think, you know, we need to understand they are much more advanced human beings. Maybe they are aliens. I don't know. I mean, you know, they have that kind of a capability. I think we need to create and amend and update our systems, the current existing systems, in a way that they have more adaptive and personalized in nature. You know, this is my thought process. Some may agree, some may not, but we need to understand the world is changing much faster than what we are expecting. Because when the 4G world started, you know, there I thought it was an amazing thing. Now 5G is going to create more than 300 sensor points where we can collect the data, whereas in 4G we have only 60. I mean, imagine after 5 years, this may be in thousands. I think the kind of a data what we are collecting is much more higher. So here the personalized and the adaptive is going to be a key aspect for the learning, because else what happens, you are dumping everything on the student and he will end up nowhere. So I think, you know, this is where I see the assessment systems needs to be very, very particular, personalized personalized as well as customized in me.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Buddha. And there is no doubt about it that this is just a beginning where use of technology is, has started in academics, right from school to university level. So, I extend my thanks to Dr. Manoj Singhar. I think he's busy in the meeting. Dr. Ravanan, Avinashji, for being with us even from there being the odd timing there. And Dr. Buddha, I know you are quite busy and you are having another meeting at 3 o'clock. Thank you for being with us, and would request you again sometimes to have more fruitful sessions. Thank you all.
Puneet,
please.
Before we close, I forgot to mention this, but I should have mentioned it in the beginning. Actually, I looked at the word education, and since this is Mission 2021, I wanted to sort of expound on that. What the word education itself contains, everything that we were talking about. The E stands for how do we create the entrepreneurs of the future. That should be the purpose of education, not just assimilation of knowledge. The D stands for development of the human individual to arise to their and fulfill their full potential. So we need to have holistic development, and education should fulfill the needs of holistic education, holistic development.
U stands for universal access. Everybody should have access. It is the imperative and it is a right of every human being to have quality education. And so we need to provide the leverage technology to provide that universal access. The C stands for collaboration, which we all talked about. Collaboration between industry, academia, government, stakeholders, various stakeholders in the system. The A stands for being able to tap not only into the ability of the individual, but also the agility with which they can learn and be able to aspire to very big dreams that they have. The T stands for technology, teachers training, as well as teamwork. I think these are very instrument, these are very crucial elements in our educational mission that should have. The I stands for, of course, innovation. How do you breed the innovation spirit in every student? The O stands for opening up the opportunities that is out there for every student to leverage education for the benefit of society. And N finally stands for, it's a national imperative of ours. It should be a national mission. How do you ensure that education actually empowers and creates the future that we all dream about?
Well said.
I think Ramananji covered everything.
Thanks a lot, Puneet, and great session. And thank you so much for allowing us to be a part of this session. Yeah.
Well, thank you. And hi, Dilip. Thanks very much. Very good for your team to organize this, Dilip.